Bismillah, alhamdulillah. We thank Allah who has given us another opportunity to meet here again on Islamic College of Sobohi Learning Program, where we used to review past questions of the two bodies of exam that we have in this country. If you are following us, we already reviewed questions under essay type, that is the theory aspect of our government exam. So at least we spent like 5 episodes to review the question across the topics of the government syllabus. Just last class, we started the second segment of the review, which is a multiple choice question aspect, that is objective aspect of our exam. So we started on the first chapter of the government syllabus, which is the meaning of government. We treated questions under it, then we treated questions under political ideologies, where we have the various ideologies like communism, socialism, liberalism, feudalism, anarchism, and the likes. So the third topic that we repeat questions under it last class that we had is a basic concept of government. So inshallah, we are commencing today's class on the new topic, which is the characteristics or system of government. Characteristics of system of government. Under characteristics of system of government, we have 5 systems or 5 concepts. So the first one is a parliamentary system of government. We have presidential system of government. We have federal system of government. We have unitary system of government. Then we have confederal. And the method I'm going to adopt in reviewing all these various concepts, the questions under them, is that I'm going to pair them together. So the two related concepts are going to be paired together. So that's what we call the peer review. So the first two that I'm going to take a look at today is the parliamentary system and the presidential system of government. As you are looking at it on the screen, so we have the parliamentary at the left-hand side here. Then we have the presidential at the right-hand side here. So what I used to do is that I will give you brief no explanation meaning on the two concepts before we start reviewing the questions. So what is the meaning of parliamentary system? Parliamentary system is a system where the head of state is distinct from the head of government. And presidential system of government is a system of government where our head of state is the same thing with head of government, that is only one person combines the functions or title of head of state and head of government. The reason why, one of the advantages that we are going to have in this pairing of the two concepts, is that they are like twins system. That is, the understanding of one will assist us to understand the second person. Like two concepts, I mean Tayi and Kainde. If you see Tayi and Kainde, they do resemble each other. So if you take a look at the two concepts, so when we are going on, you will see that they have related features. So it may be in word and opposite, but they are related. So if you understand, you have knowledge about parliamentary system of government, even if you are yet to be thoroughly learned or thoroughly be taught about the presidential system of government, you can think of it by using the features of the parliamentary system of government, because the two are related. The same thing applicable to federal structure and the unity structure that we are going to look at after this one. So you see the definition. From the definition, you can understand what I've just said now, that this one is when two persons are in the control of the state. One has the title of the head of state, the second has the title of the head of government. But this one, we have only one person that combined the two titles, the two functions of head of state and head of function. Under these two concepts, what you are expecting, the sub areas that you are expecting, so that you should extend your reading. So if at all you don't see it in the textbook available with you or in your notes, but you should notice it now that you are going to extend your reading to those areas. That's why I used to tell you the sub area that we have under each concept, as we did in the last class that we reviewed. So under the two, after the meaning, the next one is the features of the two, the features of the parliamentary system of government and the features of the presidential system of government. So after the features, we have the merits, advantages of the two, advantage of the parliamentary and advantages of the presidential. Then we have the merits, that is disadvantages, and disadvantage of the parliamentary and disadvantage of the presidential. Then another thing that we should try to extend our own study to is the functions of the prime minister and the ceremonial president under the parliamentary system of government, and the function of the executive president under the presidential system of government. Then lastly, so we are going to look at the differences between the parliamentary system of government and the presidential system of government. And what you are going to do under differences is that you are going to, since you have already learned about the features of the two, so you just need to compare their future. When you are to compare, to make differences or to make the similarities between the two concepts, you need to look at their features, their characteristics. Once you have already learned about the two features, then you can, on your own, if you are a serious student, so come about the differences between the two of them. So these are the areas that you are expected in the two concepts. So then before we go on reviewing the questions, I just want to explain the chart that we are looking at on the screen. So you will see my arrow, it points onto the citizen. So you see that at below. So it is citizens, that is the electorate. Those are qualified to vote during the election. That's what we called electorate. So we know we have the qualification for the electorate. In one of the question that we reviewed under theory aspects, we have the franchise qualification for the electorate and the under the universal suffrage and under limited suffrage. So you should go and watch that again so that you will know the qualification. So the qualified citizens is called to vote. Qualified citizen to vote during the election is called electorate. So you can see another arrow from them going to goes to legislators, and beside the arrow you could see the word elects. So means that the electorate elect the legislators across the constituencies that we have in the country. The legislators are those that make law for the country. So they are going to be elected by the citizen. So you can see another arrow from the legislators goes to the executive at the above. So beside it, you see the word select. So we see elect here, we see select here. Select means to appoint. So that is telling us that the members of the executives are going to be selected or appointed by the members of the legislature from among them. In another way, the members of the legislative arm of government, selected member of the legislative arm of government, are going to be selected to form executive arm of government under parliamentary system of government. That is why you used to say that there is no clear-cut separation of powers under the parliamentary system of government. In another word, there is fusion of powers under our parliamentary system of government, because the selected people that are members of the legislature, they are also members of the executive. So it comprises the prime minister, and its cabinet. So back, go to the presidential. At below, you will see citizens, the electorate. You see two arrows. One points to the legislators, the another one to the executive. And beside the two arrows, you see the word elect, elect. Telling us that the electorate elects the executive, the legislators from various constituencies. At the same time, they elect the executive, the head of the executive, that is the president. The ministers are also members of the executive arm of government, but they are not elected, they are appointed by the president. So, as we have legislators here, we have the executive member here. So that means that the powers are separated between the two. You know, the third organ, you should not forget it, that is judiciary. It's another separate concept. Inshallah, we want to proceed in within the questions. The first question that we have under is impeachment process is a unique feature of the A, parliamentary system, B, presidential system, C, federal system, D, unitary system. The correct answer is presidential system. Impeachment, what does it mean? Impeachment is a process of removing the executive president from the office by the legislature. That is impeachment. So it is only applies under presidential system of government. So you may be asked, maybe the question is structured in this way, that dash is a process of removing prime minister under the parliamentary system of government is called, say you understand it. What I want to say, in essence, you try to understand me, is that vote of no confidence is a process of removing prime minister under parliamentary system of government. That is, when we are having our impeachment under presidential system of government to remove the president from the office, so we are having vote of no confidence in the parliamentary system of government to remove the prime minister. The prime minister, the correct answer to this one is a presidential system of government. Question number two says, in the presidential system of government, legislative approval is not necessary for the legislative approval, that is the legislative organ. The legislative organ used to approve some functions, activities, actions of the executive arm of government. My students, I want to extend this concept, this question, to another area. You know, the question comes under presidential system of government, and I want to extend this to checks and balances and organs of government. Please be attentive to me. Under checks and balances, we have ways of which each organ is checking one another. I know under organs of government, we have three separated organs: the legislative, the executive, and the judiciary. So, among the ways of which, in which the legislative arm of government used to check the activities of the executive is through approval function. So, some of the actions of the executive are going to be approved by the legislative. So, the question now is asking us, among the options, which one is not necessary to be taken approval from the legislators? Before the executive comes to the action. So the correct answer to the question is granting of pardon. granting of pardon. Granting of pardon. So the first one, appointment of the Supreme Court judges. The legislative arm of government must approve it. Then ratification of the treaties. No, treaties is about the agreements made between two or more countries. We've learned that under foreign minister, foreign policy, that no a country can stand on its own. So you must relate with other countries politically, economically, socially, culturally. So you must benefit from other. You must lead it from them. So when you are dealing with others, that your dealings, your agreement that you made, be it bilateral agreement or multilateral relationship that you maintain with different countries. So it's what we call the treaty. So international treaty. So the approval of that treaty is done by the legislative arm of government. So the correct answer is granting pardon. Granting pardon is one of the functions of the executive. It's the same thing with the prerogative of mercy. That is the ability of the executive president to pardon a convicted person. Maybe he has already in prison for life. So the president, by his own prerogative of mercy, remove him from the office. He has that power, the ability. We call it prerogative of mercy or granting pardon is the only function in the only function is the only functions that is not necessary to be approved by the legislative arm of government out of the options that we have on the screen in the question. Number three says that the principle, it is not principle, you correct that, the principle of separation of power is less applicable in A, parliamentary system of government, B, unitary system of government, C, confederal system, then D, we have a federal system of government. Separation of power. Now, we've already understood the concept. When the powers and functions are separated among the three organs, and these functions and powers, is less, the separation of powers and function is less applicable to which form of government? Less applicable. If you do not forget, under parliamentary, we say there is no clear-cut separation of power. There is no clear-cut separation of power means that the separation of power is less applicable in it. So the correct answer to the question, my students, you need to be sensitive, is a parliamentary system of government. Parliamentary system of government. So number four says a system of government in which the head of state is distinct from the head of government is called, I think we've already said that under the definition of the parliamentary system of government. That is, we have the separate head of state and separate head of government. We don't need to waste much of our time. My students, the correct answer is a parliamentary system of government. Number five says, in the parliamentary system, the executive is weak. The executive is weak because it is A, accountable to the parliament, B, responsible for its own action, D, ABC, headed by the prime minister, D, the head of the state controls the government. It's weak, the word weak. That is, it may be that the person doesn't have a power to do some things, except to be subjected to another one's approval. So now the executive arm of government is weak under parliamentary system of government because of what? Because of one thing. The one thing is that it is accountable to the parliament. If you do not forget, under the features of the parliamentary system of government, we said that the cabinet, the ministers, are collectively responsible to the parliament, and the cabinet, they are executive, so they are responsible to the parliament. So means that they are weak. How can somebody be responsible to another organ that they enjoy the same separation of powers? They have the constitutional rights to perform certain functions. So it is weak when it is accountable to the parliament. And is this only done under parliamentary system of government? The head of government, number six, the head of government parliamentary system is the head of government of parliamentary system. We still have a parliamentary system of government. We have head of state and we have head of government. This question is related to the one of the questions that I asked you to do as an assignment under the essay type. I told you that we have the two heads, head of state and head of government. Which one is head of state and which one is head of government? Between ceremonial president and the queen at one side and prime minister at another side. So I didn't see any response up till now. But the correct answer to this question is the prime minister. Prime minister is the head of government. Is the one that has the real power, the real governmental power. But the queen or the president, which is head of state, has what we call ceremonial president, just to receive the foreign visitors and some other things like this, to honor the national pledge and some other things. So these are the ceremonial functions. The same thing that we've experienced during the first republic of this country. When we had Tafawa Balewa as head of government, then Nnamdi Azikiwe as head of state, ceremonial head of state. So the prime minister, as they are practicing it in Britain, has what we call the real power and is the head of government. So under presidential, so the head of state and head of government is combined in the president. So alhamdulillah. So number seven, in the presidential system of government, the president can constitutionally be removed from his office through impeachment. I think the first question that we review, that we looked at, is the same thing with this. You can see the logic that I used to say that the two bodies of exam, they don't have new questions. So the same questions that you have already learned, the same information that you had with you, that you have learned directly from your teachers in the class, that you have learned in your textbooks, are the same information with the exam bodies. But they used to restructure it. If you try to, study the past question, you will see how the questions are, restructured, so as to confuse those of you that are yet to get the subject matter very well, that are yet to understand it. So if you do understand it very well, you will not have problem. So you will understand how they used to, change the restructure of the question. Number eight says, a notable feature of cabinet system of government is A, collective responsibility, B, a separation of power, C, violation of human rights, D, impeachment of the executive. Notable, the word notable, you underline it. If at all, my student underlined, if at all the options are the features of the cabinet system, and cabinet system is the same thing with parliamentary system, I think you know that. If at all the options are the function, are the features of the parliamentary system of government, the one that is notable among them is collective responsibility. Collective what? Responsibility. Meanwhile, not all the options there are features of the cabinet system of government. You take, for example, violation of the human rights. They are there to protect the human rights, fundamental human rights of the citizens. They must not violate it. Separation of power is not clear. There is no clear-cut separation of power under the parliamentary system of government. Impeachment of the executive is not done under parliamentary system of government. We have it under the presidential system of government. What we have under parliamentary system of government is vote of no confidence. So the correct answer to the question, as we've underlined it, is collective responsibility of the ministers to the parliament. Number 9, all the following are the condition for adoption of federalism estates. All the following are the conditions that we need to consider when we want to adopt federal structure in the country estates. So the word estates, you need to give it a special attention. Which one is not among the factors that we need to consider anytime we want to adopt federal structure? The correct answer to the question is homogeneity. Homogeneity is when the people of the country are of the same language, the same tribe, the same culture, the same norm. The opposite of heterogeneity, when the people of a country are of the different languages, different cultures, ethnic groups, and the customs. And that one is the features of federalism. This one is the features of a unitary system or government. So that is the correct answer. Number 10 says, which of the government has a function of ceremonial and the executive function as a feature? A, presidential; B, cabinet; C, federal; D, republican. If you look at the question very well, the student may be confused, which can lead to choosing of wrong answer. Because we said earlier that the fusion of powers is applicable under parliamentary system of government. But here they use the word fusion of the ceremonial and executive. That's what we meant by the fusion of powers under parliamentary system of government. What we meant by fusion of powers under parliamentary system of government is that two functions, the function of the executive and the function of the legislative arm of government, are performed by group of people. The same group of people, the minister and its cabinet. But this one is telling us that when the ceremonial function and executive function are combined in one person, which system of government has the fusion of ceremonial and executive function as a feature? That is the presidential system of government. So under presidential system of government, the president, the executive president, is performing the function of the ceremonial functions and the executive functions. But under parliamentary system of government, the prime minister is performing the function of the executive function, and the president is performing the function of the ceremonial functions. In another way, the head of government is performing executive functions, the head of state is performing the function of the ceremonial functions. So you understand that is the differences between the parliamentary system of government and the presidential system of government. The next one that we are moving to quickly, because the time is running out, is federal system and the unitary system. As the previous two that we have revealed are twin concepts, this one are also the twin concepts. So because they are about the structure of government. This one, the federal system of government, is when the powers and functions are shared, constitutionally shared, among the tiers of government. This one, unitary system, is when the powers and functions are concentrated in the hand of the single authority, that is the central government. So I want to refer you back to what you have learned under your first term of SS1, under the basic principle of government, where we learned about delegated legislation, no checks and balances, separation of power. So among the things that we learned there is centralization and decentralization. Decentralization, when the powers are shared, divided, division of powers and functions among various organs, among various tiers. But centralization, when the powers and functions are concentrated at the center. So that is why I have something like this. I don't know if you can see it. I said centralization is a political arrangement of federal system or government. So centralization is the political arrangement of federal system or government. Decentralization. So this one, centralization, is the political arrangement of the unitary system or government. You can see the charts. So we have the federal here, we have the state, we have the local government. But here, we have the central government, then we have the subordinate units. What happens under that is that a subordinate unit can be created by the center. But here they are existing and they have the relative autonomy, independent from the federal system of government. So here we have the divisions of functions under what we call legislative list. So into three lists, we have the exclusive list that is meant for the federal government alone. We have the concurrent list that is meant for the state government alone. Then we have the residual list for the state and the local governments. So we do have some concurrent list, under concurrent list, sorry, we have some functions there that are, you know, can be performed by the federal at the same time by the state. But under the residual list, we have that of the state and the local government. So we have peculiar functions under different lists. So like custom and currency, immigration for the exclusive list, that is for the federal government alone. But under concurrently, we have the higher education, the health centers and the likes. So it means that the federal and the state can perform the function under the list. The residual is for the state and the local government. Then the questions under it, we want to look at them one by one. The first one, which of the following country is operating a unitary system of government? Be a unitary constitution. The unitary system adopts unitary constitution. And which of the following countries that is using it? So what I will advise to my student, if it is not provided for you in your textbook or in your class, you can also Google search it on your phone. So the countries in the world that are practicing unitary system of government. But the correct answer to this question among the options is the Britain. So number two, a unitary system of government is most suitable for a highly religious country, b country with a lot of minerals deposits, c small homogeneous country, d highly populated country. The correct answer is a small homogeneous country. The country that is small and homogeneous, that is they are of the same culture and of the same language, is suitable for unitary system of government. Quickly, the system of government in which authority is shared by the center and the component unit is called, we don't need to waste much of our time, we've already said something about it. It's a federal system of government. That is FEDAW, sorry. This is federal system of government. That is option C, is the correct answer. The FEDAW system, you know, when the economic of the country, the control of the land is, you know, centered on the Lord, shared from by the pastor through the military service, then worked on the land by the south. So here we have the advantage of federal system of government is that an advantage of federal system of government is that a promote economic development, facilitate quick succession, is less expensive to operate, encourage unity in diversity. Correct answer is encourage unity in diversity. You know, I said earlier that heterogeneous nature of the society is one of the factors that make a country to adopt federal system of government. Federal system of government is when we have different people, different ethnic groups, different cultures, custom, and they are under the same government. So it means that because they are diversified in culture and everything, but they are united at the top under one government. At least there is unity in diversity. Unity in diversity, that is the correct answer. Then quickly we are moving to the next one. This one says, in federal system of government, the power shared between the central government that is known as power shared between the central government and the state government is known that it's known as concurrent list. You know, I said something on this when I was saying something about the legislative list, the function, division of functions under federal system of government. So when the federal and the state can perform the certain function, examples of the function under it is establishment of higher education, you know, university, we have state university, we have federal university, like health center, we have federal hospital, we have state hospital. Abi, or your state, they have usage at the federal and they have idea, you have state hospital. Almost all the country or the state are the same. So the next question is, all the following are the condition for adoption of the federalism, except the same question with that, I think it is repeated. So the prayer answer is the homogeneity. Then the last question that we are going to look at, the two last questions are: the federal government is a form of decentralization. I think we've already said that. Decentralization. I think my student, you are funny me. So allow we aid your understanding as regards all the topics in our government levels. Number he say a country with homogeneous society and small population is suitable for the establishment of the unitary. So inshallah, we are going to put stop on this now. So next episode, we are going to start from another review of other questions. So inshallah, we pray that Allah should spare our life and aid our understanding and make us be successful in our exam. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.